we were going through borders like every single day, and there were like strict borders where you'd have to have all your paperwork, your IDs, all that ready. So if we were trying to do that just through English, I'd say it would have been a complete disaster. Like there was one day, I can't even remember what country you were going to or from, but let's say the gig was about half an hour away or an hour away, so we left in the morning to tip away over. But whatever way, they wanted ID, and we only had passports. But apparently, you know, all of Europe, they have like just like ID cards that we don't have here. Like, so none of us had them, and they wouldn't accept the passport. So we had to go, instead of just driving an hour over this way, we had to go back through the country and through another border. So it was like a it made into a 9-hour journey.
Oh, Jesus.
Yeah. So we just about made stage time, like, you know, 5 minutes sound check or whatever for the gig. Oh, it was that was hellish.
You're laughing about it now, but it wasn't very funny at the time.
No, tensions were fairly high when we got on stage. And you know, you had the venue, like the rep or the owner or whatever, being like, yeah, you know, come on, you're late. And you're like, yeah, you know, we know. Leave me alone. Like, we've just been 9 hours in the car. Like,
that's some trip. I actually did a 9-hour trip within Ireland once. We had we played in Dunfanaghy.
you go around twice.
No, we played in Dunfanaghy, which is the top corner of Donegal, and we had to do a wedding reception for a fan in Skibbereen in the next day. So it was kind of like traversed the whole country. It took 9 hours. It was fucking mental.
Did you drive down after the gig or something, was it?
No, in the morning. We got up really early and then just hit the road, and we arrived just in time to do the wedding reception. But it was very relaxed. He wasn't expecting like a big full energy CBC show. It was just a bit of music while people are eating their cakes and drinking tea after the wedding kind of thing.
Just as well.
Yeah, but that's cool. I what's the rock crowd down that part? Because we play in Spain a bit, and they're amazing. The audiences, they're just like gagging for gigs, and they kind of treat every band like they're a famous rock band coming to town, regardless of who they are. Like,
yeah, it's kind of the same out that way as well. We had some amazing gigs there, and yeah, they're actually really into the rock as well. Like, so, you know, within the set, kind of goes on Mark's stuff, goes for everything from, you know, he might do a couple of songs on his own, just on acoustic, and then to full on like riffage and, you know, tearing into it. So, and they love it. Like,
yeah, I was listening to one of your songs. What was it? Enemy of, I think it's off.
Oh yeah, yeah.
The new album. And I was hearing a bit of kind of Colin Greenwood in your playing. Would he be kind of someone you'd be the Radiohead bass player, or is that just a coincidence?
No, that was actually Mark played that himself on that album.
Oh, really?
But having said that, I do love Colin Greenwood, and I think he's unbelievably underrated.
Because I was listening to your playing on one of the good ones, one of Mick's songs. And you were doing this kind of wobbly bass sound. I was wondering how you got it. And it was also Colin Greenwood sounding that went on like.
I guess it's kind of a filtery thing that it was Christian Best. So he plays drums with Mick, and he also records the majority of Mick's music and produces. So he, like, we would have had, when we were recording, the idea that it was going to be some sort of filter or effect on the bass, because it's kind of a repetitive kind of chugging part or whatever. And so he would have gotten that sound. He's pretty cool like that. Like, you know, if he can kind of get out there and get weird with this, he's happy and under.